Hello everyone and welcome to another video on ECG. My name is Dr. Wajid Shabir. I have done FCPS in cardiology. This is the ECG which we are going to discuss today. Before going into detail of this ECG, as always, pause your videos, note down the findings and diagnosis with yourself, so that at the end of the video, you can compare the diagnosis and your findings with the discussion done in this video. Now coming towards the discussion on this ECG, as you know, the first thing which we look at on an ECG is rhythm. And for rhythm, we look at the long lead or lead to at the bottom of the ECG. And if there is a P wave present before each QRS complex, it signifies the presence of a sinus rhythm. Here in lead 2, you can see that there is a prominent and upright P wave before QRS complex. Similarly, here you can see another P wave after a QRS before a QRS complex. So this means that this is a sinus rhythm. Now normally, in the sinus rhythm, you find a regular R-R interval, meaning that the distance between two R waves should be equal in case of a normal sinus rhythm. Now here we can see that the R-R interval, it is variable between these beats, these two beats and the next two beats. Similarly, here the RR interval is smaller as compared to the next RR interval. So here we can see that the rhythm is irregular. Although it is originating from sinus rhythm, but it is irregular. Similarly, here you see a normal run of RR interval followed by a very prolonged RR interval. So what is the reason for this variability of RR interval? We can find out by looking at the relationship between the P waves and QRS complexes. In the first beat, you can see that the P wave followed by QRS complex, then T wave. Again, there is a P wave followed by QRS complex and T wave. Now, after the second beat, immediately after the T wave, you can find another P wave. But after this P wave, there is no QRS complex. Again, the next P wave is followed by a QRS complex. Again, P wave followed by QRS complex. And then after this QRS complex, that is the fourth QRS complex, you can see another P wave without any QRS complex, which means that this P wave is not conducted to ventricles. Now, whenever you find this type of pattern where P wave is not being conducted, there could be two possibilities. Either there is a atrioventricular conduction defect, or there may be premature atrial contractions which are not conducted to ventricles, which are called non-conducted PACs. Now our main objective is to differentiate between any AV conduction block and a non-conducted PAC here. Now if we consider this P wave being on a broad vertical line, we can calculate the atrial rate between these two P waves by calculating the large boxes as 300, 150, 100, and 75. So this P wave, it lies between 100 and 75. It is around 80 to 85 beats per minute. So technically, the next P wave, it should be coming off at a rate of around 80 to 85 beats per minute. So we calculate the rate between these two P waves. Again, it is 300, 150, 100, and 75. Again, this second P wave, it lies between 100 and 75. For this P wave to be a premature atrial contraction, it should come earlier as compared to normal P wave. But here we can see that the second P wave, it is almost at the same rate as compared to previous two beats. So we can say with surety that this is not a premature atrial contraction. So this is a normal sinus beat which is not being conducted to ventricles. Now, what type of AV block is this? Now, to confirm this, we look at the PR interval and RR intervals. Here we can see that the PR interval is constant in cases of conducted beats. Here you can see that the PR interval in conducted beats, it is constant. So presence of a constant PR interval means that either it could be a first degree AV block or it could be a Mobius 2 AV block. For that, we look at the RR intervals. If the RR intervals are constant, then it means that it will be a first degree AV block. And the second important thing which should be present in a first degree AV block is a prolonged PR interval, which is obviously not present. Here we can see that the PR interval is less than 200 milliseconds or one large scale or five small scales. Second thing in case of a constant PR interval would be Mobius 2 AV block. As we know that in case of Mobius 2 AV block, the PR interval is fixed while the RR interval is variable. As we have already established, the RR interval in this case is variable. And with PR interval being the constant, this is a Mobius 2 AV block. So next thing is the axis. In axis, we can see that the QRS complex in lead one is directed upwards while it is directed downwards in case of lead AVF. So this is definitely a left axis deviation. Next important and prominent thing which we can note is a broad QRS complex, which is just above three small scales, which means that there is associated interventricular conduction defect as well. So we look at lead V1 and lead V6 to find out whether it is a left bundle branch block or right bundle branch block or a simple interventricular conduction defect. Here we can see that there is a deep S wave in lead V1 along with a R wave in lead V6 without any S wave. So presence of deep S wave in lead V1 along with the R wave in lead V6 means that this is a left bundle branch block. So in an ECG, when you find a Mobius 2 AV block along with a left bundle branch block, it means that the patient has a advanced underlying conduction defect. So in this case, irrespective of any cardiac symptom, that is of shortness of breath or syncope or presyncope, irrespective of all those symptoms, the patient would need placement of permanent pacemaker because patient is at risk of progression of this heart block to complete heart block with the passage of time. So this patient needs a permanent pacemaker. So this is all for today. Hopefully you like the video. For more videos, kindly subscribe to our channel and stay tuned. Allah Hafiz and take care till next time.